Welcome to today's Talks at GS session. I'm very excited to welcome back a member of the Goldman Sachs family, Robert Smith. Robert is the founder and chairman and CEO of Vista Equity Partners, a technology-focused private equity firm. They manage over $25 billion of assets. Robert worked at Goldman Sachs from 1994 to 2000. You're the chairman of the board of Carnegie Hall. You're the chairman of the Robert Kennedy Center for Justice and Human Rights. You're a trustee of the Boys and Girls Club of San Francisco, founding donor, very important donor, to the Smithsonian National Museum of African American History and Culture. So welcome and thank you for being here
today. Thank you, good to be back.
So I always like to start from the beginning.
Sure.
You grew up in Denver in a predominantly black middle-class neighborhood. Mm-hmm. Your parents were educators, but I've always heard encouraged your passion for technology. Your mother took you to a march in Washington.
Yep. You know, I grew up in Colorado, fourth generation from there on my father's side. And many of you in this audience are too young to remember days of what we called segregation and desegregation of the school system. So my class as a first grader, I went to was the first class really bust to create integration in the school system. And I grew up in a neighborhood that was a wonderful neighborhood in many respects. It was very community oriented. My dad was the principal of the school down the street. My neighbor was a guy by the name of George Brown, was one of the first African-American lieutenant governors. And across the street, I had an African-American congressman who sat a state congress. We had a very diverse community economically as well. But the thing that was most important was education, educational pursuits. And my community was very focused on ensuring that my generation of children had an opportunity after Brown versus Board of Education to now get the best education that was available, which meant, you know, public school education in Denver, Colorado. But to arc it forward, I go to high school. It's a public high school, same high school my father went to, and it was a wonderfully integrated place in terms of people and culture and, you know, socioeconomic. But then I took a computer class. And from that computer class, I said, wow, this is really interesting. In my teacher, because they weren't professors.
You're in high school now?
In high school. Yeah. And it was a junior. I was a junior in high school. And he started telling me about, you know, the basic components of a computer and started talking about transistors. And, well, what is this transistor? He told me a little bit about it. It was invented at this place called Bell Labs. I said, well, they must have some pretty smart people, though. Let me go check that out. So I go to the guidance counselor and say, what's this place called Bell Labs?
Like,
and
they've got a great story.
Yeah. So I call them. And I say, hey, you know, I hear you guys have summer internships. She said, yes, we do. And she said, if you're between your junior and senior year in college, you know, we have internships. I said, that's fantastic. I'm a junior in high school. I'm taking all AP classes. I'm getting all A's in my AP classes. It's the exact same thing. And she said, no, it isn't. And
but that didn't stop you.
Of course not. So I literally called her every day for 2 weeks. And then I called her every Monday, because after 2 weeks, I figured out I'm just wasting, you know, 10
wasting
cents a day.
Yeah. So
I just called every Monday after that for 5 months. And I get a call back in June. And they said, listen, you know, a student from MIT didn't show up. We have an open slot. We don't know. Remember, they've never met me. I go out, you know, get the one suit that I owned and get $2 in my car and, you know, gas, because that's could get you out there. And I interview. And fortunately, I learned that I could actually sell my talents from time to time, and I got a job at Bell Labs. And that just opened the world for me, because I saw things. I saw the first cell phones way back when, that, you know, took 15 years before they were commercialized. And I saw communication systems, and I saw, you know, the applications of science that I would have never known about growing up in my neighborhood. That changed my life. And from that, I told people I discovered the joy of figuring things out.
So you get excited about technology. You're at Bell Labs and all. Let's jump into your career. You join Goldman Sachs in 1994.
Yeah.
You join our technology business. You know, you're at the firm, you know, 6 years or so. You've been involved in building this franchise. But how did it feel, or what was going on in your head when you walked in and you said, hey, I'm going to leave and go start my own business? What was going on in your head? Because, you know, if you think about it, that was 1999, right? Or 2000.
Yeah, 99. So here's where that starts. So, you know, remember, I was an engineer for 6 years. Think about that. So I got a chance in my early part of my engineering career to work on some of the early implementations of software into process industries. Think about it, software, technology, probably the most productive tool introduced in our business economy in the last 50 years, enterprise software. And then I run into this little software company based in Houston, Texas. I take them on as a sell side project. And through that, I learn how they're running this business. And I say, oh my God, if you actually took what they use as their best practices and laid them across these enterprise software companies, you could make a fortune. They said, what do you guys do with all this money? And they're buying CDs, certificates of deposit. You know, this is 97, 98, 99. I said, and they said, well, what would you suggest? I said, well, there's this thing called private equity. They said, well, what is that? So I told them what private equity is. And they said, well, can you introduce us to some of these people? I said, sure. And they came back and said, a lot of them seem to be in the asset aggregation business as opposed to truly the value creation business. I said, well, that's a fair assessment. Yeah. They said, what else? I said, if I were you, I would take that money and I'd drive it into these enterprise software businesses. I'd take these best practices that you all have and I'd apply them across these companies and you'll probably do okay. And they said, that's the best idea we've ever heard. Would you be interested in being a general partner if we were the limited partners? And I said, well, I'm not too sure about that. And so that's what led to the formation of Vista.
Yeah, great story.
Yeah.
It's a great story. And it's, you know, it's you look back in history, it's one of the things big organizations have to wrestle with.
Yeah.
You know, they get momentum going in a certain direction. And there are great stories about people who have great ideas that sometimes can be executed in platform, right, but for a variety of reasons, they wind up off platform.
Yeah, and the key is, yeah, you know, and this is the challenge I know I face, mm-hmm, and you know, I know you face it at a much bigger scale, is creating an environment that evolves.
Yeah.
Right? But you have to be thoughtful about creating an environment where new ideas of innovation are not only welcome, but they're encouraged, they're embraced, and the success of them are trumpeted.
Sure.
Because otherwise, you have the risk of, like all things, you know, the complacency factor, you know, leads you down a narrowing road of opportunity. And look, I face it with my own firm now, 18 years, you know, 17, going on 18 years in the making, of how do we make sure we don't atrophy on what we were good at? And oh, by the way, how do we ensure that we continue to evolve our culture on the one hand and expand our business opportunities in the markets that we're in?
When you kind of sit in your perch and you look out, what are the businesses today that you think are most fundamentally vulnerable to technology disruption, and where are the moats the deepest?
Man, you sure you want me to tell the truth about this?
Absolutely.
Okay. So here's the thing. We are truly in the early stages of the fourth industrial revolution. There is a digitization of every single industry on the planet, and ultimately that will lead to the digitization of every single company in one way, shape, form, or another. You read about it all the time, but you really have to, you know, depending upon what group you're in, you gotta get into the bowels of it. What do I mean by that? You have to now start to evaluate what is creating productivity in all its measures at the company level, and what technology, and then to what extent it's gonna impact jobs and opportunity, okay, and what impact is going to, you know, to some degree, disintermediate entire industries.
Absolutely.
You know, you've seen it. Like, you know, we have these talks about, oh, you know, everybody wants to be a king, right? No, you actually want to be an emperor, okay? And that's what Bezos has done,
mm-hmm,
if you think about it, because now you can actually, you know, disintermediate entire industries if you have the right platform. The next thing I think about is, you know, what creates... you know, as a chemical engineer, I like to think about the world in states of equilibrium. What is the next state of equilibrium in an industry? So that's the next lens through which I look at an industry. And if you can do that, you're going to know what's going to participate in that ecosystem of equilibrium and what is no longer necessary for that ecosystem to remain in equilibrium.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So to a great extent, if you take the insurance business, well, do you need underwriters or do you just need underwriting? Okay, and then you have to ask yourself, well, do you need underwriting or do you actually need to just have some way to manage risk? Okay, and then you say, well, on the investment side of the house, do you really need investors to manage that risk or you just need to match assets with the liabilities over dated periods. So think about the equilibrium states. What is going to be the equilibrium state that can be achieved leveraging current elements of technology, which have now accelerated through true machine learning, true artificial intelligence, and through true cognitive development associated with it. Mm-hmm. You see what I mean? Let me give you an example. If you are in the automotive business, and you are a very large-scale automotive company, and you make cars, or you make trucks, you participate in only one slice of that industry. But the equilibrium of that industry is going to be supplied by the parts, the supply chain
and the changes.
All of it.
Massive, yeah.
Right. But you can't control that whole ecosystem. So from an opportunity perspective, the way we think about it is, how do we become leaders in the ecosystem as opposed to participants in the silos? So that's to give you a sense for where we go and how
interesting
we...
Interesting way to think about it.
Yeah.
Very interesting. There are a bunch of businesses that call themselves technology businesses, but really what they are is their marketplaces or the liquidity providers that basically intermediate people that need a service and
right.
need software.
Yeah, yeah. I call them capacity planning businesses.
And they take a spread.
Right.
Are there moats around these businesses, or for the most part is the acceleration of a bunch of these businesses and brands that are trying to aggregate and put different supply demand
right.
capacity together, is this a short-term phenomenon that ultimately becomes just as competitive as anything else?
Yeah, it's a great question. Here's the thing, and I call them these capacity planning tools. You're matching some capacity and demand, in demand for some service. It might be a ride down the street or a room in a city or something of that sort. The fundamental thing about software and technology in most of these markets, in the past, it has been a winner take all market. But that's what I keep talking about. There are emperors, not just kings. Right now, you got a whole bunch of kings in these spaces. They will consolidate. There will be one emperor in that space, mm-hmm. most likely. Now, it may be a geographic emperor, okay? And then it's a question, do they have a broad enough platform that they can move, report to other adjacent spaces? Bezos did probably the best job in our lifetime of knowing that and building a platform that accelerated so that you didn't figure that out till 15 years later. It's like, oh my goodness, it just eliminated four industries, not just one. So the best and critical thinker. So when you all are evaluating businesses, listen to who is the critical thinker about the platform as opposed to the product. Oh, gee, I can, out Uber Uber, out Lyft Lyft. Okay, that's great, but that's not the point. The whole
point is...
It's
not going to be the platform.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay? You've now got to... Look, it may take 15 years.
Yeah.
Okay, so those moats have to get dug over time, and it can sometimes take 10 and 15 years.
It take a long, long time.
But
by the way, something that looks
something
that looks very protected, all of a sudden 15 years from now won't be protected.
Yeah, but what's so interesting, when you do it, if you get it right, you mm-hmm. own that market for decades.
Yeah.
So it takes a massive amount of investment,
yeah.
but then you can own it for decades as opposed to years or to quarters. And it's just a question, in our fickle investment environment, they're giving you a quarter at a time to kind of prove yourself.
So to finish up here, just a quick lightning round.
Sure.
Okay. What advice do you give your younger self?
I would have probably come to Goldman Sachs earlier and left earlier.
But stayed the same amount of time.
Probably.
One word to describe your computer ability.
Fading.
What part of your day do you enjoy most?
The mornings. The mornings are spectacular. I love being at home in the morning when I get to see my kids wake up and greet the day and drop them off at school, the ones that are, I'm still dropping off to school. And that is a spectacular part of the day.
If you weren't in finance, what would you do?
NBA, no. If I weren't in finance, I'd be writing code. Honestly, I would frankly be in the true software business, thinking about which industry we could disrupt or we could with some products or some solution that no one else has in the market today.
Last book you read?
Good Profit by Charles Koch. I'd highly recommend it. And also Between the World and Me, Ta-Nehisi Coates.
I never get tired of
seeing you. No.
Oh, God. Your life's much more exciting.
Yeah, I honestly never get tired of talking to tech people and software people. It's just an amazing world. It's awesome.
This year's NBA champion.
Whew, man. I've got to go with my son's favorite, which is Golden State Warriors. So
we'll see.
All right.
Robert, thank you.
David,
really
thank
great
you.
To have you back at Goldman Sachs. Real quick. Thanks very much.
All the best, man.
Thank you.
Really great.
Appreciate it.
Really appreciate it. Really great.